No, un punto a caso, ma
il più vicino possibile.
Sì, perché vedi, cioè, qui c'è la rotonda. E lì c'è la rotonda. Quindi io mi metto lì e leggo le coordinate.
Ok, so the calibrator is named Luca. I don't know if there is someone called Luca between us. You?
No, no.
Ok. Luca is, let us calibrate.
Nice, good day.
And let's have a look quickly to this image. That is an image that has a lot of things. This is an image that was taken from the work of Grayson and Blochel of 2001, which is really significant, since you can see here that we have this. This is the answer also to your question. Giulia, lei, come Giulia, anche, no, come ti chiami?
Elisa,
scusa, come sei così, Elisa?
Sì.
Look at this image. It's a sort of answer to your question. It's a really nice image in which you can see that here there is the model complexity. So you have a small model complexity, and then here a large model complexity. And here you have the data availability. So you have a small data availability and a large data availability. And here is the predictive performance of the model from small to large. And here you can see that the optimum is not when you have a very complex model and a small data availability, because a very complex model then requires a lot of data, but there are few times are available. And on the contrary, if you have a lot of data and small model complexity of the opposite. So you are
Well, I totally agree, but this applies also for the bubble transpiration.
Yes, absolutely. So we go back.
Yes, yes. Complex bubble transpiration.
Yes. Actually, it depends.
Other models.
It depends on your case study.
Yeah.
More you have, and the more you get. and let's see. Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so let's have a look to the scene file of Luca. Okay, so you have to specify one Luca scene file for each calibration you are going to. So, if you want to perform seven calibrations, you have to do seven Luca scene file, first of all. So here is the setup of Luca. So you can change here in name, the name of the calibration. This is strongly suggested because Luca overwrites the results. So if you are doing more than one calibration, I strongly suggest you to change the name, otherwise you lose your results. Okay. Then here are the paths to the topology and to the sim files. Okay. Here is the path to the parameters. Okay. And here are some information that are related to Luca. So it's when the run starts, when the calibration starts, and when the run ends. So let's assume that we are going to calibrate the run and the start of the run. The start of the calibration is the same, and the end is the end of the calibration, okay, of the run. This is the rounds. The rounds are the number of, let me say, of cycle of calibrations that you want to that Luca performs. So for example, here you can put one round or two rounds. It means that Luca calibrates, I will show you 200 times within a round, and then it takes the best best parameters set, the best calibration that he get, it gets, and then start a new round with the best and tries to always to get better results within the round. So you can, for example, you can do 1, 2, or 3 rounds. Then you have the parameter definition. So here are again exactly the same parameters you have in the parameters file and in the sim file with exactly the same name. Here are the range I was telling you before. So there are some of these ranges that are more or less fixed, because we saw that are literature values and they are fixed, and other that you have to set and are Bayesian specific. So for example, the parameter related to the snow, to the rain, snow separation, and to the snow components is the one, this one. Have some of literature values range, so you can leave this range as they are. The same is for K, which is the parameter of the canopy. The PB soil, you can leave it as it is. And also the parameters related to masking, so X and the UC, which is the severity of the channel. The parameters instead, which you can play and you have to do the sort of sensitivity analysis that I told you before, are the parameters related to the reservoirs of the root zone, of the runoff, and of the groundwater. So for example here, I put that the lower value of the maximum storage within the root zone is 50 millimeters, the maximum is 500. But you can see that in your basin the minimum is 100 and the maximum is 300, so you have to check the range of these parameters. How you put these parameters and you do a sort of sensitivity and you see if your storage is decreasing too much, if the reservoirs are emptying in time, and you see the general behavior of your sub-basin, or your basin actually. And then there is the last part of the Lucasin file, in which here method you define the objective function, the index of goodness that you want to optimize. There are four choices, which are the clean, for example, here I put the clean UCTA efficiency. You can optimize the Nash half-life. You can optimize the root mean square error. And you can optimize the percent bias. Some of these indexes are well known, others you can find the formulation almost everywhere. You will learn with time that some of these are useful. For example, the KGE tends to optimize the mean value of discharge. The Nash half-life tends to optimize the peaks within the discharge. So it depends again on what you want to get. Here you put the no value within your time series, measure the time series, so it's -9999. Then here you have to put the path to the simulation. So for example, here you have hydrogramma 4, that is the one that we generated before. And the value 4 is the number of the eddy, the column that it has to consider. The same here, observation, is the path to the observed values. So here is the Cavone underscore SS106, which is the State Road 106. And here again we have a column which is the column number 4. Finally, we have the execution that I was saying before. So within a round, you have 500, in this case, 500 of execution. So it tends to optimize 500 the index of goodness. Then if you specify 2 rounds, it stops at 500. It gets the best set of values that you obtained, and then it starts from that set and does 500 of calibration again. Okay.
Like a maximum number of, or where it gets like an optimum, I guess, if you would set whatever 3000, then at a certain point it doesn't get any.
Yes. So it stops. It can, this is the maximum number of execution, but if it reaches the best within 100, so into execution,
yeah.
It stops.
Okay.
It says, the index of goodness didn't rise in the last 20
yeah.
runs and calibration stopped. Okay, I'm going to tell you some information about Luca. Important, very important and useful information. Okay. So the first information I want to stress it is the range, the determination of the ranges. So again, you have to check your range before launch calibration, because otherwise you don't get anything good, first of all. The second important thing is that if you set the parameters range, for example, let's see the root zone, the storage maximum, the maximum storage within the root zone. Here is varying between 50 and 500. But here in the parameter file, this value is 600, so is outside the range. Luca doesn't work. It doesn't optimize nothing because it is out of the range. But you have to be careful because it doesn't say anything to you. So at the end you will get that you have exactly the same set of the beginning. So you lost your time. Okay, this is another important information. The other important information related to the sensitivity analysis is that if your storage is are acting in time, so you put the wrong set of parameter and your storage is doing something like this. Okay. This will cause a problem in the solver of the ordinary differential equation. This means that Luca goes into a loop and it doesn't stop, but is within a loop. So you can leave your calibration on and then after 10 hours it is stopped. It is still trying to go ahead. But what we did is when you launch, okay, let's open the loop. When you launch a calibration, it prints okay the parameters that is using. Why? Because if it stops somewhere because of this problem, you can see which is the set of parameters that caused that problem. And then you stop the calibration, you go here, and you change the range of calibration. Okay? So for example, in this case of Luca, there are some parameters that I commented. this means that I'm going to optimize it only few of these parameters. Why? Because I don't want to optimize all the parameters, because in this case, for example, just to have a faster calibration, I commented some parameters. But if you want, you can decomment the parameters and let it calibrate.
Laura, it is possible to change the tolerance for the optimization of the params?
In Luca, no.
Okay. And which is the tolerance? Okay.
We have to check on the code.
Okay.
Instead, in particular, Dorm, yes, you can change the tolerance.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. I was. Telling to one of your colleagues previously that the calibration is something really tricky because first of all you are going to calibrate one set of parameters for your entire basic. So that's why Ricardo yesterday said that the discharge is not the most important information that you get from an hydrological model, even if it's the one that is most common used. But you understand that if you calibrate just in one closed section, now we have seven sub-basins, but imagine that you have a big river. You can imagine that one set of parameters maybe is an ensemble mean of all the parameters that you would get if you can, if you could calibrate in each of these sub-basins. So in theory, if you calibrate here, you get a set of parameters, but if you calibrate in each of these sub-basins, you get seven different sets of parameters, different from the only one that you have calibrated just once, first of all. And then the calibrators are not the perfect machine at all. So, for example, there can be local minima, maybe Giuseppe showed you something like this. So maybe the calibrator stopped here, but your best is here. So you, it is not that you run, okay, that's the best. You have to check the parameters. So you run a calibration, you get the results, and then you go back, you do a simulation, and you check. Are you happy with your calibration? Yes, okay, no. But you have to do change your range of parameters, change your goodness of fit. Now, for example, you're using two, the KGE, use the Nash sublife, use the root mean square error, and then you can, if you're lucky, arrive here. Okay. Let's have a look to the output of Luca. So for I tried to calibrate all the parameters of the model. So I can show you an example of a completed calibration from Luca, and it's the same that you will get from the calibration that you will run. So Luca gives you a report for each of the for each round that you set. So round zero, S0 is basically the before start, and then you have round one, but you have a Luca summary that gives you all the information. Okay.
Stop. It's give a cross. Place.
There is one.
No, okay. I'll
enter the set. Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Come si blocca una situazione.
Close to the plane.
Yeah.
Where is the cross?
Yes,
okay.
Close to the plane, yes.
Qua. X. Stop.
Okay.
So in the first part of the Luca summary, there are all the information top of the calibration.
Where was the local summary file?
Okay.
Which folder?
Yeah, okay, we should. So if you open, for example, Luca Pavoni Hall, which is the calibration that I made at home last week, you go in out, and then there are all these files. If you, for example, put rounds 2, here there should be another file. Okay. Then you open Luca Summary, and here is the summary of what you did. So, for example, here he said that the run period was this one, the calibration is exactly the same, the output folder is here. And then it records all the values of the parameters, the initial values of the parameters. I calibrated everything, so here there are a lot of parameters. Okay. Here are the information about Luca, which is the shafted complex evolution. Here, for example, are 200 of executions. Okay, here is the percentage of the objective function is 0.01%.
Okay.
Here it reports the objective function that I choose, so it's the KG, at the value of the optimized column. Okay, but here are the information that we want. So the objective function value that he reached is 0.78. That I don't know if you know the KG. The KG, the worst is 0, the best is 1. But you can get also negative values, and then you have to, I don't know, restart from the beginning. And then here they, it reports the best, the optimized value. Mean here, this is the same number. So here, this is the best value that you got. So 1.14, 1.11, here is the name of the parameter. So alpha S, this is the best. For alpha R, this is the best. And so on. So for each parameter, so for example, let's go to the ring for runoff. Okay, here's the maximum storage within the root zone. The best we got is 171 millimeters. And so on. So once you get and done, if you put two rounds here, there should be the results of the round one and round two. Okay. So usually in two rounds, the index of goodness improves. So maybe if I pass from 0.78 to 0.81, okay. Sometimes no, it depends. Usually there is improvement. Okay. And then what you have to do? You have to take this optimized parameter, and you have to report in your parameter file. Here I already created the file, all. I call it all because I optimized all the parameters. So is let's see, UC is the selector of the channel, Luca summary is 0.761. It reports a lot of numbers under the dot, but you can do just the first three. Okay, and then you have to do a run again with your graph and see the output that we got.
Sorry, what's the name of this text file?
What's the name
of this text file? Because the font
is ERM underscore params underscore all.
Thank you.
on stage with me. Okay. Hopefully. I suggest not to run the calibrations right now, mm-hmm. because the computer would be out of order for 2 hours, more or less. But we have some nice exercise that I prepared for you,
okay.
if you want to do it today. Otherwise, if you want to do other other stuff, that you can do your other stuff. That, as you prefer. I just show you the exercise and then you should. So, for example, you can try. Okay, as regards to the calibrations, you can try, for example, I gave you the sync file of Luca with some parameter commented. You can try to use the same sync file but changing the objective function to see if the calibration improves or not. Or you can decomment some of these parameters or all, because I already gave you one optimization. You can try to change the ranges, or you can try again to change the. So you, for example, this night, this evening, you go to your bed and breakfast. Okay, you put here an hash stack in front, and then you go to the bed, and tomorrow we see what happened. If your computer is still alive or not. Okay. But now, for example, we can play a little bit with the graph. So, for example, we can try to connect or disconnect the HRU7. Actually, I gave you the 7 already connected, so you can try to disconnect the HRU7. Try to see how to connect and disconnect part of the graph. We can try to change the closure section from 4 to 5. And try to see if we are able to. We can try to use multiple sets of parameters, so we can change the parameters within the RM params and use multiple parameters. Run a multi-site calibration is complicated, we will see tomorrow. You can try also to insert at the DAM within to substitute the node number 3 with the DAM if you are interested. Or do what you want. But just to try, start with the calibration. Run a calibration, because if you have problems, we try to fix it here. And then you stop again, easy thing.